We're really excited about having Dr. Lisle here. Probably there was no way that we could get Dr. Lisle to come here except for the fact that he's doing a big conference that will be held later this week at the Griffin Center. And they've had to move venues now twice because they've outgrown the venues. And they've now filled the rip up and are having to use overflow at Green Lawn. And they filled the main auditorium at Green Lawn up. And now they're filling the gym up. So if you want to go to that conference, you need to register. They don't have very many places left. So you need to register as soon as you can for that. Dr. Lisle is the Director of Physical Sciences, and he leads ICR's gifted team of physical scientists who continue to investigate and demonstrate the evidence for creation. He graduated summa cum laude from Ohio Wesleyan University, where he double majored in physics and astronomy and minored in mathematics. He earned a master's degree and a PhD in astrophysics at the University of Colorado. Dr. Lisle specialized in solar astrophysics and has made a number of scientific discoveries regarding the solar photosphere and has contributed to the field of general relativity. And if you don't know what that is, you can ask him afterwards. After completion of his research at the University of Colorado, Dr. Lisle began working in full-time apologetics ministry, focusing on the defense of Genesis. Dr. Lisle was instrumental in developing the planetarium at the Creation Museum in Kentucky, writing and directing popular planetarium shows, including The Great Cosmos. And there's a lot more that we could say about Dr. Lisle, but I want to give him most of the time. So I will go ahead and let you come on up and introduce you, Dr. Lisle. Come on up and speak.
I want to thank you very much for having me out here to speak. It's a joy to be with you this evening and talk about how science confirms biblical creation. I'm with the Institute for Creation Research, and of course we do a lot of publication of how science confirms the Bible. We are Christians. We're unashamedly Christians. We believe the Bible is the true history of the universe. And frankly, we want people to be saved. We want people to come to know Jesus as Lord and Savior. And when we're preaching the gospel, there are objections that come to that, right? People will say, no, you can't trust this book, and one of the main objections they would say is, well, because of science. Science has somehow disproved the Bible, especially in the area of creation. That's the one area where they'll say, well, yeah, maybe. I'm cutting out a little bit, aren't I? They'll say, well, maybe you can trust it when it comes to Abraham and Moses and things like that, but not Genesis, not creation, right? That's the place where you can't trust the Bible, because we know millions of years of evolution is true, allegedly. That's what they claim. And that's a shame, because science really does confirm biblical creation and not evolution. Well, hopefully, when I'm done this evening, you'll see that there's a lot of evidence that confirms biblical creation, and you might even scratch your head and think, how could anyone believe in evolution? I hope you have that sort of feeling. And I want to kind of start by dealing with that. Why is it that there are brilliant people out there, and there are brilliant people who believe in evolution, and I've worked with some of them at the University of Colorado, and you know, there's a tendency for some creationists to sort of downplay the intelligence of evolutionists, and I don't think we should do that. I think we need to be respectful of people who are made in God's image, even though they're wrong about some things. The reason is, it has nothing to do with intelligence. You see, the reason that there's a difference in the way we think about evidence is because we have a different worldview. We have a different way of interpreting the evidence because we think about the world in different ways. And so my secular colleague and I, we look at the very same fossils. I look at the same stars and galaxies that they do, but we look at them from a different perspective. I'm thinking in terms of a supernatural worldview where there's a God who can do what he wants and he upholds the universe in a consistent way, and so science is possible. My secular colleague tends to think in terms of naturalism, slow, gradual processes, gradually producing the galaxies and Earth and life on Earth and so on. And so they've already got that viewpoint going into the evidence. People like to think that scientists come to the evidence neutrally. Nobody does that. You can't. We all have a worldview. We have a way of thinking. If you don't have a way of thinking, you don't have a brain. Right? I mean, we all have a way of thinking. And so we all have that worldview. You can't get away from that. Whereas I look at the universe from the perspective that God's word is true and that the biblical history is the true history of the universe, and I have every reason to believe that. We'll take a look at that tonight. And at the conference, I'm going to show you a way that you can actually demonstrate rationally that the Christian worldview is the right worldview. So you'll want to make sure you come to the conference. But tonight, I'm just going to take a look at some of the evidence and show you that it's consistent with what the Bible teaches. I think it's helpful for every Christian to know just some of the basics in fields of science so that you can intelligently dialogue with a critic, someone who says, no, the Bible can't be true because we know evolution's true. Well, no, you really don't know evolution's true. And let me show you, you got some problems if you believe in evolution. That's the goal for tonight. And I'm only going to cover three fields of science, and I'm going to do it very briefly. I'm going to cover genetics, the study of how traits are passed on from one organism to the next. We'll talk about information theory, which maybe you've never heard of, but it's really neat and very confirming of biblical creation. And then we'll talk about geology, things like rocks and fossils, paleontology, which is the study of the fossils in those rocks. And we're going to see that in all these cases, the evidence really does confirm the biblical timescale and the biblical account of history, not just the timescale, but the biblical account of history. We'll start with genetics, which is the study of heredity, how traits are passed on from organisms, the study of these different variations we find in organisms. And I'm going to focus on animals. In fact, we're going to focus in on dogs because we like to see how dogs reproduce quickly, and we can sort of see how they do that. Do dogs change? That's my first question. Do animals change? Do dogs change?
Yes.
Yes? What do they change into? Dogs. That's right. Okay. See, creation is not hard. Dogs do change. And God has put that ability in them, and we'll see that as we go through this evening. The reason I point this out is because a lot of times evolutionists will do what's called a straw man argument, where they misrepresent their opponents, and they say, well, creationists believe that animals don't change. Well, no, I do believe animals change. They just remain the same kind. And so you can get lots of different breeds of dogs from two. And we believe that originally happened because on Noah's Ark there would have been two dogs. And so we do get all these different breeds from two. There's no doubt about that. And we'll see how that happens. And we'd expect that on the basis of what the Bible says, because the Bible talks about God creating animals after their kind, or according to their kind. That's a phrase that's used 10 times in Genesis chapter 1. We better take that seriously. So animals reproduce according to their kind, but they don't reproduce exact clones. For the most part, they produce a little bit of variation, but they remain the same kind. Kind is not the same as species. That confuses some people. Species is more specific. Kind is probably more at the family level, although there doesn't have to be an exact correlation between God's system and man-made system, right? But generally, it doesn't mean species. And so, you know, there's a group of mosquitoes that goes off and it lives in a cave for, you know, 100 years, and when they bring it back out, it can't interbreed with the parent population. So they classify it as a different species because it doesn't interbreed anymore. But they're still mosquitoes. They're still the same kind. You can get speciation, but they remain the same kind. See, the misrepresentation, what evolutionists say creationists teach, is something like that God created all the animals exactly as we see them today, and that is not what I believe. I don't believe that God created poodles in the Garden of Eden, right? It was a paradise, so you're not going to have poodles there. We're going to see that animals have changed a bit, and not always for the better. So that's the misrepresentation of what we believe. The true representation of what we believe, but more like this. God did create kinds back at the beginning, and they have diversified since creation. And so that, you know, the dog kind is split into lots of different varieties, and poodles are just one of these one of these little branches that happened. And we'll see why that occurs. Some kinds have gone extinct. Some varieties have gone extinct, but the rest of the kind remains. Like elephants, the mammoth is part of the elephant kind, we believe, and yet there's no mammoths around, but there are other varieties of elephants that made it. And so you get the idea. And of course, a lot of the kinds have gone extinct, but that's not our focus today. Our focus is the change that we see within those kinds, and that's what we see, change within kinds. And that's exactly what we'd expect in the creation worldview, change within kinds. And that's what we observe in science. Science is all about observation, experimentation. This is what we observe. Whenever we do experiments on animal breeding, you always get the same kind, no exceptions. In the evolutionary view, they believe that all life is descended from a common ancestor. That is their belief. I actually had an opportunity one time to speak to a group of atheists, interestingly. Of course, they believe in evolution because they have to, because they don't believe in a creator. But, I mean, they do. That's it. If you don't believe in God, that's the only story you can really buy. But and I mentioned to them, you know, in your worldview, you believe you're related to a turnip, And afterwards, some of them were bothered by that. And they said, weren't you kind of poking fun at us? And I said, but isn't that what you believe? He said, well, yeah. And I said, well, there you go then. Don't shoot the messenger, right? I mean, I'm just repeating back to you what you believe. If it sounds silly, it's not my fault. That's your belief. Maybe you ought to reconsider your belief, perhaps, right? So I wasn't trying to be mean. It's just that's what they believe. All life is descended from a common ancestor, and so there really aren't any kinds in the evolutionary view, right? Because you can't draw the line anywhere. Now, to see which of these two is confirmed by science, we need to know a little bit about DNA, which is a long molecule that occurs in the cells of your body. It looks something like a twisted ladder, and on the rungs of this ladder are these little nucleotide base pairs, and there's four different kinds, and they're abbreviated by those four letters that you see there. And they're arranged in different ways. You might have a C, then a G, then a T, then an A, or whatever. You can't predict in advance what the order is going to be. And that order spells out the instructions to make proteins, which make up you. And so it's kind of like you could spell, in the same way you could spell help with beads on a rope, and that's Morse code. In the same way, DNA spells the instructions that make you, which I think is amazing, right? I mean, we think we can get all this information on a Blu-ray disc, and that's impressive. But God put the instructions to make you on a molecule. That's impressive. And you got 3 billion of those instructions, and even that's kind of amazing because that seems almost too small, and yet we're now understanding that God used some kind of compression algorithms that we don't fully understand. It's really astonishing because some of those strands, you can read them forward, and then some of them you can read backwards, and you get other instructions. It'd be like writing a book that you read it, and then when you're done, you turn it upside down and read it the other way, and you get another story. I mean, we couldn't do something like that, but God apparently has, at least in certain sections of DNA. But anyway, you have two sets of DNA. You get one set from dad, you get one set from mom. They had two sets of DNA, and so on. And you get certain sections from each parent. So you might get, you know, that gene from dad and that gene from mom. A gene is a section of your DNA. And depending on which two you get, you'll have certain characteristics. And so, but you know, your siblings will get a different set probably, unless you have an identical twin. And so they'll have different traits. But my point here is you got all the instructions, all the information to make you. You got it from your parents. It's just you have a unique combination of DNA, which is why you look a little different than your parents. Right? Yet some of the instructions are the same, and so you have some traits that are the same as your parents and some that are different. And that's why. Here it is with a blood type. And so if you have this combination, big A, big A, your blood type's A. If you have A and O, A is dominant, O is recessive. Maybe you remember doing this in school, and so your blood type's still A. And here, these are the combinations that'll give you the B blood type. A and B are co-dominant, so you get AB blood type. The only way to get blood type O, which is very common, is to have both O alleles. Allele's one of the gene possibilities. And that's actually a common blood type because the O allele is very, very common. Now, the thing I find interesting is if mom has blood type A, and it's this combination, the heterozygous A, and dad has blood type B, the heterozygous B, you know, the O and the B, the children could have any blood type. You have A like mom, you could have B like dad, you could have AB, which neither parent has, or you could have O, which neither parent has. So you can have traits that neither parent has, but you still got the information from them, didn't you? That's the key. All the information that's in you was in your parents. Kind of interesting. Works the same way with skin color. This is simplified, but the principles here are true. We basically have the same skin color. It's brown. It's just a question of how much do you have. There's a pigment melanin. There's a couple different forms of it. But in any case, if you have a lot of melanin, you tend to have, you have these genes, and so you tend to be darker skinned. And if you have this combination, you're lighter skinned. Well, if you're in this combination and you marry somebody in that combination, your kids are going to be in that combination because that's the only combination possible is the lowercase letters, right? And likewise here, get married to somebody in that box. If you're in that box, then your kids will be in that box. But if you're off axis, if you're over here, and you have big A, big B, little B, and you get married to somebody in that box, your kids could be anywhere from very light to very dark. And so we think Adam and Eve probably had a middle brown skin combination. There's other ways that God could have done it, but that's one way. And there are places in the world today where that happens as well. Likewise with dogs. You can get all kinds of different varieties of dogs. God built in a lot of different combinations of genes into the original two dogs that were on Noah's Ark anyway. And for that reason, you can have all different kinds of varieties of dogs, and we're going to really focus in on that because I like dogs, actually, even poodles, believe it or not. Now, it seems to me that if evolution's true in single-celled organisms, something like bacteria, eventually evolved into horses, which is what evolutionists believed, then it seems to me that the information in their DNA had to increase right? Because bacteria have some instructions in their DNA, and a horse has a lot more instructions in its DNA. It's a more complicated critter. It has instructions to make, you know, eyes and ears and bone and things like that. Bacteria don't have those instructions, and therefore they can't produce those traits. So it seems to me, if evolution's true, information has to increase in DNA, right? If bacteria are going to turn into horses, somehow they had to gain brand new instructions, the instructions to make hooves and bones and tails and what have you. So evolution is all about an increase in the information content of DNA. It's not just that a horse has more DNA, which it does, but it has more actual instructions, more information, more instructions in its DNA. It'd take a much bigger cookbook to make up a horse than it would to make a bacteria. But by the way, even bacteria are complicated. You know, people say, well, that's a simple form of life. Well, let's see you make one. They're complicated, but a horse is more complicated. You get the point, and it requires more instructions. And that's very interesting because you see the processes that we observe in nature reduce the amount of information and don't increase it, or perhaps neutral. But isn't that interesting? Because, in fact, one of the processes I'm going to talk about is natural selection. And a lot of people think natural selection is evolution. It's not. It's actually the opposite when you understand it. Natural selection is a true principle of nature. I'm going to show you how it works. But we're going to see it's the opposite of evolution, because evolution is about increasing information. Natural selection only decreases it. And so suppose you have two dogs, okay? And we'll suppose they have a gene for short fur and a gene for long fur. And suppose those genes have a combined effect, which some do. And so they have medium length fur. Again, this is simplified, but the genetic principles are true. And so they fall in love, and they get married, and they have, I do this for kids sometimes, so they get married, and they have offspring, right? And so now some of the dogs are going to get the short gene from mom, the short gene from dad, and they'll have short fur. Some of them will get a short gene from one parent, a long gene from the other, and they have medium length fur just like their parents. In fact, statistically, 50% of the offspring would have that combination. And then some of them will get the long gene from mom, the long gene from dad, and they'll end up with very long fur, okay? No problem. Now, is this evolution at this point? Well, no, we haven't gained any new information, have we? We started with information for short and long and by combination medium, and we ended up with information for short and long and by combination medium. No new information. It's not like the dog has become a different kind of animal. It's still a dog. It's not evolution. But natural selection kicks in. Let's suppose the environment gets very cold. Now, the dogs that have the shorter fur are not as well insulated against the cold, so they're rather uncomfortable in that environment, and so sadly, they die. Yeah. Very sad. I didn't say natural selection was nice, I just said it was true. What happens then is the dogs that have the longer fur go on and meet other dogs that have longer fur and reproduce. Now, the ones that have the shorter and medium length fur don't reproduce because they're dead. Right. So the dogs that have the longer fur reproduce, and what kind of offspring are they going to have? They're going to have long fur offspring, exactly, because that's the only combination that's possible at this point, you see. If the environment gets hot, are they ever going to go back to having short or medium length fur? The answer is no.
There'll be no dogs.
That's right. And that would be sad. So again, is this evolution? No, because we haven't increased any information. In fact, we've lost information, haven't we? Because we started with information for short and long, and by combination medium, and we ended up with information just for long. That's all that's left. The death of an organism just removes that information potentially from the gene pool unless it's carried in another organism, you see. Now, if we started the experiment over again and you had all three varieties, and this time, let's suppose the environment gets very hot, well, now the dogs that have the shorter fur, they do better in that environment, right? And the dogs that have the longer fur, they don't do so well. They die of heat exhaustion. And so in that case, the dogs that have the shorter fur meet other dogs that have shorter fur, and they reproduce, and you end up with lots of dogs with short fur. And this happens. We see this happen in the real world. But it's not evolution, because we started with information for short, long, and medium, and we ended up with information just for short. It's in the opposite direction of evolution. Natural selection is the opposite of evolution. It really is. And it's something we observe in the real world. We find, lo and behold, dogs that end up in colder climates tend to have the longer fur. If they didn't, they'd die. Dogs that end up in the hotter environments tend to have the shorter fur. If they didn't, they'd die. And so on. And we're talking about wild dogs here, dogs that have to fend for themselves. And so, we can account for the different breeds of dogs and why they fit the particular environment that they're in. You only need two dogs on Noah's Ark, and they get off Noah's Ark, and they reproduce, because dogs reproduce very quickly, and they spread away from the mountains of Ararat, and they take certain traits with them. And if those traits are not conducive to survival in that environment, then those dogs tend to be eliminated from that environment. They tend to die. And of course, some traits are sort of neutral, and then it really doesn't matter. It's just sort of luck of the draw, which way it went after the flood. But this is why we find animals that are well acclimated to their environment. It's the genetic information that God placed in them, and then natural selection, the culling of information that's not conducive to survival in a particular environment. So this is how we account for the different breeds of wild dog. It's not a problem. It's not evolution, it's just dogs. That's all it is. What about mutations, though? Evolution will say, but Dr. Lisle, it's not just natural selection, it's natural selection and mutations. That's what really drives evolution. So we need to talk about a mutation. A mutation basically is a mistake in your genome. You can think of it as a typo in your DNA. And that often occurs in the process of copying, as your DNA is copied, because you got it from your parents, and there had to be a lot of cell divisions for that to happen, so it's been copied many times, and sometimes it's not copied perfectly. And so what happens is some information will be lost, or it'll be scrambled. And so dogs should have information for four normal legs. All dogs should have information for four normal legs, but because of a mutation, some of that information gets lost, and you end up with the dog with short, stubby little legs. Now, if you think about it, a dog with short, stubby little legs like that really can't do very well in the wild, can he? Because he can't run very fast on those legs, and he can't get away from anything, and he can't catch anything himself. He's not likely to do so well in the wild. And so we find that, to some extent, mutations tend to be weeded out a little bit in nature. Some of them, of course, if a mutation's fatal, and some of them are, some mutations that will cause your heart not to form properly, you're dead. And that one's immediately eliminated then. But there are some that just sort of make it inconvenient. But that can reduce the chances of an organism surviving. So in the wild, you're not going to find dogs like that. But some people like dogs with short, stubby little legs because they can't jump up on you as much. And so people will, when they find these mutations, they'll say, that's great. And they'll find other dogs that have those mutations, and they'll breed them together, and you end up with lots of dogs with short, stubby little legs. And they don't need to fend for themselves, right? Because they have a human caretaker who will feed them and give them water and spend millions of dollars trying to keep them alive, right? Because they're missing some of these instructions, right? And so that's why domestic breeds of dogs tend to be full of mutations. They really are. There are all kinds of mutations in dogs. There's a mutation that causes a dog's snout not to form properly. Dog's supposed to have a long snout, and that helps with the smell and so on. But there's a mutation that causes the snout to be short, and they have this horrible underbite then. And the skin was designed to fit the longer snout, so it kind of hangs off the side. If you don't clean it, it can get infected. And some people think that's cute, but the dog, probably not so much. Yeah, that's maybe not real convenient for him, but in any case, domestic breeds do have problems. Poodles, for example. They're cute. I'm not anti-poodle, but they do have some problems because of mutations that have accumulated in their genome. And some of these are secondary results. For example, there's a mutation that causes a poodle's hair to grow forever. A dog is supposed to grow its hair so long that it falls out, and that regulates the hair growth. With the poodle, it just grows indefinitely. And so there's no way that could survive in the wild, right? Because it's trying to drag all this hair behind it, right? There's no way it could survive. And so you have to shave your poodle every now and then if you want them to be comfortable anyway. And if you don't even get in their ears, and they can get in their eyes, and they go blind and so on, it can cause them a lot of problems. And so they have these problems because they've lost some information. But is this evolution? Well, we haven't ended up with a new organism here. It's still a dog, right? I mean, barely, but it's still a dog, right? It's kind of the bottom rung of the dog, but it's there. It qualifies. It's missing some instructions, but it's the same kind. And so we haven't gained any new information. We've lost some information, and as a result, we have some diseases that we have to contend with. And so this is how we account for the different breeds of domestic dogs. It's just a combination of the information God put in the genome and mutations, little mistakes that have crept in and caused some little errors in the traits that form in these organisms. So you see, this isn't evolution because it's in the wrong direction. Evolution is supposed to be sort of an uphill process, gaining new information. If you're going to turn bacteria into horse, you got to add new instructions to it. But natural selection is the opposite. We think the dogs that were on Noah's Ark, by the way, would have been closer to the wolf kind, because the wolf variety still has a lot of heterozygosity, a lot of big A, little A, and so on. And so, in principle, if you took two wolves, in principle, and you selectively breeded them and picked the offspring and selectively breeded them, theoretically, you could get down to a poodle again. I don't know why you'd want to, but you could, right? But on the other hand, you can't take two poodles and ever get back to the dog, back to the wolf kind, right? Because they've lost some of those instructions, and there's no way to get that back just by inbreeding them. And when I do this for kids, I like to say that the information in your DNA is like jelly beans, and so you got the more wild kinds of dogs tend to have lots of information, lots of instructions in their DNA, but through selectively breeding those, you see, you get down to the poodle, and then you don't have a whole lot of information left. As you can see there. Now, could you ever turn a dog into a cat by removing those jelly beans? The answer is no. No, you can't, right? Because cats have different instructions. They have different information in their DNA. They have instructions to make a cat. How about that? Whereas dogs have instructions to make a dog. And you can't, by removing those instructions, change one kind into another. It's just not going to work. Now, by the way, I should point out some instructions are the same. You have some instructions that are the same as a banana. You say, well, why is that? Is that because we evolved from a banana? No, it's because we need some of the same proteins that bananas have, which is why they are food for us, you see. God theoretically could have made all organisms with totally different DNA, and therefore they'd have totally different proteins, and therefore they would have no nutritional value, you see. If God had done that, the only thing we would be able to eat is each other, and that would not be good. So it's very important that God made, you know, organisms with some of the same instructions, but they have different instructions too. And you can't get that through mutations and natural selection. So again, when we take a look at dogs and we see how dogs reproduce, we find they beget dogs like themselves. And a lot of variation there, to be sure. But it tends to lose information and not gain it. This is good observational science, right? This is something we can test and repeat in the present. That's what science is all about. And we find it confirms biblical creation. It does not confirm millions of years of evolution. Not at all. I should point out mutations can be beneficial. Evolutionists sometimes like to parade that. They'll say, well, occasionally a mutation can help an organism in a certain environment. And that's true. But it still doesn't help them because it's still a loss of information. It's still in the wrong direction to make evolution happen. And for time's sake, I'll just give one example, antibiotic resistance. Some evolutionists would say, see, this is proof of evolution right here. We got bacteria that have evolved a resistance to penicillin or other antibiotics, and that can happen, but it's the opposite of evolution. Let me show you why. You got H. pylori, which is a type of bacteria that causes stomach ulcers, and those are unpleasant, and so what you do, you go to the doctor, and he gives you an antibiotic, and so you take the antibiotic, which is harmless to you, but it goes in, it's absorbed into the bacterium, and then he's got an enzyme in him that's just part of his internal chemistry that when it reacts with that antibiotic, it converts it into a poison, and the poison kills the bacterium, and you feel better. And you pay your doctor, until you pay your doctor bill, and then you don't feel so good. Okay, there is a mutated form of H. pylori, and that mutated form lacks the ability to produce that enzyme, or at least not very much of it. That enzyme that's normally part of his chemistry, that's been lost. That information has been lost, and so he can't produce it. And so when the antibiotic goes into them, it just sits there because he lacks that ability, and he survives, but he survives because he's lost some instructions, and that can help an organism under that particular circumstances. So what happens then is you kill all the normal ones. The only ones that are left are the ones that are resistant because they're missing some of those instructions. And by the way, that's why you need to take all of your antibiotic even after you start to feel better. When you start to feel better, you've killed off all these ones. And these ones, though, they're hanging in there because even they have a little bit of that enzyme, and so eventually the antibiotic will kill them too. It's just they're resistant to it. But if you stop taking your antibiotic, the only ones that reproduce are these ones, and you have a resistant strain, and they're harder to kill the next time, you see. But this is not evolution, because we haven't evolved a new organism here. We started with bacteria, we ended up with bacteria, same kind, same species even. And we haven't gained any new instructions. We've actually lost some instructions. It's just that in that unusual environment, it happened to benefit them. Dr. Lee Spetner, his PhD in biophysics, Johns Hopkins University, says all point mutations that have been studied on a molecular level turn out to reduce the genetic information, not to increase it. He says not even one mutation has been observed that adds little information to the genome. Isn't that interesting? And yet, in the evolutionary view, you're made of these information-increasing mutations, right? Because bacteria don't have that many instructions. They don't have a very long DNA chain. And yours is 3 billion base pairs that have allegedly added new instructions to you. But he says not even one adds a little bit of information. There are different types of mutations. There are ones where a section of a DNA can get duplicated. People say, there you go, that's adding new information. Is it really? If there's a mistake in a newspaper where a paragraph accidentally gets duplicated, do you have any new information? Could you learn anything by reading the duplicated paragraph that you couldn't learn from the original? There's no new information there, right? So anyway, when we take a look at genetics, we find that applying good observational science, we find that information decreases in these organisms. It doesn't increase, and so that's consistent with original creation, and that information's been copied, and some of it's been lost over time. It's consistent with biblical creation. Well, we've been talking a lot about information. What is information? Let's move on to information theory. And this is an exciting field of science. It's relatively new, at least in terms of becoming a, more and more people are becoming enamored with it because it's interesting in the computer age to talk about information. What is information? We sort of know what it is, but how do you define it? Well, it involves, it always entails three quantities. First of all, it involves a symbolic code system. And so if I pick up a book, this book, it doesn't have to be the Bible, but this is the Bible. And it's got information in it because it's got, for one, it's got a code system. This, for example, here it says Israel. Here's the word Israel. Now, I don't see Israel here. I see a word which represents Israel. It's a code system. This one happens to be English. The Bible's originally written in Hebrew and Greek, some Aramaic, but yeah. Language. There's a language convention. Again, this one's English. There's grammar and syntax. There's rules, right, and for, in terms of when sentences start and stop. And so it obeys that rule, too. And there's meaning. There's an expected action and an intended purpose on the part of the reader. God didn't write this book just, you know, as a sort of a, like a diary or something like that, right? He wrote it for us to read and to learn and to modify our behavior. We're supposed to do this, and we're supposed to act on it. We're supposed to follow his commandments. We're supposed to trust in him for salvation, right? So there's an action expected on the part of the recipient. There's a purpose so that we'll have eternal life. That's the purpose. And so those are characteristics of information. A cookbook has information in it because it's got symbols, right? This ingredient, and it labels the ingredient. It's a word that represents sugar or whatever it is that you're making. There's a language convention, probably English. And there's meaning. There's an expected action. The action is that you'll mix that ingredient with that one, and the purpose is for you to not go hungry, right? So it's got information in it. Here's an example. Could this be information? Could be. It looks like there's probably a code system there, right? Is there language? Maybe. It looks organized. It looks like there could be language there. Is there meaning? Is there expected action, intended purpose? Now that you can't know until you translate it. But usually when people find things like hieroglyphics, they think, well, yeah, there's probably language there. We need to decipher it. And I can tell you this is information because I know what the code is, you see. This is actually Genesis 1:1-5 in the form of icons. See, in the beginning, the clipboard, in the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth, and the earth was without form and void, and darkness was over the deep, and the Spirit of God was hovering over the waters, and so on. You see that? And so it fits our criteria. It's a symbolic code system. There's a language convention. There's grammar. It follows syntax. And there's meaning. It's telling us the origin of the universe. Now, it turns out, whenever you have... Once you identify, yes, this has information, there are certain laws of nature that apply to it. Just like when you have energy, there are laws of nature that involve energy, right? There's the law of conservation of energy, which says you can't create or destroy energy, you can only transform it. There's the, you know, there's, in the same way, there's laws of information. And one of those laws is what Dr. Werner Gitt, one of the world's experts on information theory, has as his theorem number 28. He says, there is no known law of nature, no known process, and no known sequence of events which can cause information to originate by itself in matter. And so basically what he's saying here is if you just have a box of matter, rocks or whatever it is, and shake it up or do whatever with it, it's not going to suddenly become information. That makes sense, right? Where does information come from then? Well, he talks about that too. He says, when its progress along the chain of transmission events is traced backwards, every piece of information leads to a mental source, the mind of the sender. So according to Theorem 15, Dr. Werner Gitt's understanding of information theory, information always is sourced in a mind. Always comes from a mind. Now, information can be copied by a non-mental process. A Xerox machine can copy information. That's no problem. But it can't create information. Only a mind can do that, you see. And again, that seems to be a law of nature, where there are no known exceptions. And sort of, you know that, right? I mean, if you picked up a book and it had creative information in it, if it had instructions on whatever, how to bake a cake or whatever it is, you wouldn't assume, well, this was probably produced by an explosion in the typewriter. Right? It's just sort of random. There's no mind behind it. No, you wouldn't assume that. You would assume if you picked up a book and it had creative information in it, that there's a mind behind it. And you'd be right. So again, the copying process doesn't have to have a mind behind it. That can be non-mental. A Xerox machine can do that. And a Xerox machine might malfunction, and then you lose information. That can happen too. But in order to create information, that takes a mind. Now that's very interesting, because what do we have in DNA? We have information. All the information to make you. Now, where did you get that information? You got it from your parents. It's copied from them. Where did they get it? Copied from their parents, and so on, all the way back to Adam and Eve, who got it from God. It goes back to the mind of God. So you see, information theory is consistent with biblical creation, isn't it? Because the information in the DNA of all organisms originally came from God. And some of it's been lost through that copying process. And for that reason, we have little problems. We've accumulated mutations in our genome. We have. And so we're all a little bit like the poodle. I hate to tell you that. We are. And so that's why after I stand for a long time, my back hurts because something down there didn't form right. I'm missing some instructions, and I don't know what it is, but my dad has it. I got it from him. He got it from his dad. So you get the idea. But you see, information theory is not consistent with evolution, because evolution says the information in our DNA came about by chance. As these information increasing mutations accumulated. But we've never observed that in nature. Observational science tells us that information always comes from a mind. And by the way, in their heart of hearts, evolutionists know that information always comes from a mind. They really do. And I know this because I did a social experiment a while back. I have a blog, it's just my name, jasonlisle.com. And I posted this article called On the Origin of Articles. And it's an absurd article. It's supposed to convince you that articles have no authors, but that they started out as one word or maybe even one letter, and as they were copied, mistakes were made, and occasionally those mistakes would improve the article, making it longer and better. And that's how articles are millions of years old and have evolved from single letters, right? And that explains why they have certain words in common, like the word the. That word is in so many different articles. Obviously, they share a common ancestor, right? Well, anyway, you can read this. It's a crazy article, and it uses all the arguments that evolutionists use to try and persuade people that organisms have evolved, but it works just as well on articles. It really does. It works just as well. The funny thing was not so much the article. The funny thing was the responses that I got to it, because I allow evolutionists to get on there, and I interact with them a little bit, and it was funny. We know you wrote this, Dr. Lisle. I said, how do you know that I wrote it? Did you see me write it? Well, you're just taking it on faith? That's interesting. Well, we could look up your IP address. Hey, I admit to posting it. When this thing evolved on my machine, it was too good not to post, right? I said, well, it was funny because they couldn't come up with a reason. Now, actually, they could, right? All they had to do was say, this article has information in it. That can't come about by chance. But the moment they say that, evolution's gone. Isn't that interesting? And they did not win this debate. I played the part of the evolutionist, so to speak, arguing that articles have evolved, and you're one of those crazy authorists that believe that articles have authors. I mean, that's fine, but keep it in church, all right? It was fun to play that part, and it was interesting. They couldn't come back from that. Or SETI, the search for extraterrestrial intelligence. Have you heard of that program? They're listening for alien radio signals from space. Of course, there's a lot of radio signals in space. I don't know if you know that, but stars give off radio waves. It sounds like static. I've listened to this. I've heard the static that comes from the sun's pulsations, for example. It's not pleasant, but it's there. So with all of these natural radio emissions, how would you distinguish an intelligent radio transmission? And the answer is the intelligent transmission would have information in it. Yeah, and they know that. If we got instructions from space on how to build a warp drive and we built it and it worked, wow, there's intelligence out there. That hasn't happened. I don't think it's going to, but you see my point. You see, even secularists know that information always comes from a mind because the whole SETI program is predicated on that presupposition. And yet the same evolutionists look in DNA and they say, oh, that didn't come from a mind. That's just chance. Inconsistent. Well, what about geology then? Let's talk about rocks and fossils, and I think the first thing we need to talk about is the age of these rocks, because I went through the public school system and I was taught that the world's billions of years old, 4.5 billion years old, and that these rock layers were deposited over hundreds of millions of years of gradual accumulation. That's not what the Bible teaches, and that bothers some folks. And how do they know that these rocks are millions and millions of years old? Well, they don't know that. But how? What causes them to come to that conclusion? Actually, they need that. They need that conclusion for evolution to work, because we all know that evolution doesn't happen in our lifetime, right? We can see that organisms only beget organisms of the same kind. Their only hope is to say, oh, but if you waited long enough, eventually one kind would change to another. They need the millions of years. And so they have to believe in an ancient Earth, no matter what the evidence is. But isn't there radiometric dating, right? Doesn't that prove billions of years? Well, let's talk a little bit about radiometric dating. I think it's good for us to know at least a little bit about this. We're all made of atoms, these little particles, and most atoms are stable, which means they remain the same kind of atom. But there are some atoms that are unstable, and, or also called radioactive, and they will spontaneously change into another type of atom. Uranium-238 is an example of one of these radioactive or unstable atoms. It will spontaneously change into thorium, which changes into that, which changes into that, so on. Those are all unstable until you get to lead-206. Lead-206 is stable. So once you reach lead-206, you stay lead-206 forever. And you don't have to do anything to it. It just happens spontaneously. And you can't predict when any one atom is going to change. But when you have a group of them over enough time, you kind of know how they're. It's kind of like popcorn, right? You don't know when any individual kernel is going to pop. But you know if you leave it in the microwave for 2 minutes, that's going to be most of them. Okay? It's the same idea. It works the same way. So the bottom line is, if you had a chunk of solid uranium, and you waited a long time, eventually it'd be part uranium, part lead, part of the intermediate elements as well, which I haven't displayed for simplicity. And then eventually it would be all lead. Uranium does change to lead. We know this. This is good observational science. We can do this in a laboratory. So the idea is, let's suppose we found a rock that had some uranium and some lead in it, right? And that would give us some estimate of how old the Earth is, because we could extrapolate. We know the rate at which the uranium changes into lead. It's very slow. And so we could extrapolate back and figure out when it was all uranium, you might think. But wait a minute, how do you know it was all uranium to start with? Maybe the rock started with lead already in it, right? I mean, that's a possibility. Well, how much lead should we assume that the rock started with? Well, you tell me how old you want the rock to be, and I'll tell you how much lead it started with. You see the problem there? It's kind of like, you know, if an hourglass, if you came into this room and there's an hourglass there and it looked like that, and I say, how long ago did I set that up here? You say, well, that's easy, Dr. Lau, half an hour ago, because it's an hourglass. It's about halfway done, right? I said, I got you, because in fact, the thing was sideways when I came in. Already half of the sand was in the bottom chamber. See, you assumed all the sand started in the top chamber, and that's not correct. It wasn't. Or how do you know that someone didn't add sand when you weren't looking? Or how do you know the throat of the bottle's always been the same size? The sand's always flown through at the same rate. That's probably pretty reasonable for an hourglass, but not necessarily for radioactive decay. We don't exactly know all the principles of radioactive decay. And we know that it is possible to speed it up under certain circumstances. In fact, we've been able to speed up certain kinds of radioactive decay in a laboratory by a factor of over a billion. So we can make very major changes. So those are some of the assumptions. Radiometric dating is, here's my point, it's based on assumptions. And if any one of those is wrong, you're going to get the wrong answer. Bottom line is this, though. We've taken rocks from a recent volcano, and radiometric dating is supposed to tell you when the rock hardens. It only works on volcanic type rocks, okay? And it tells you when the rock hardens, because that traps the minerals, and that sort of sets the zero point on the clock, because they can't move in and out of the system anymore. So we took rocks from a recent volcano, and so we know their true age. And we sent them into a secular lab to have them age dated. Now, why would you do that? It's expensive. Because we wanted to test the method. We know what the answer is in this case. And you know, those rocks came back with ages of hundreds of thousands to millions of years, even though they're brand new, a few years old. Mount St. Helens erupted in 1980, okay? So they're not hundreds of thousands or millions of years old, but that's the age estimates that came back. And you say, well, that's an anomaly. Actually, that's pretty typical. If you go to Hawaii and take rocks from Hawaii and send them in and have, you know, you could stick a pole in the magma, let it harden, brand new rock, send it in, you'll get millions of years as the age estimate for that rock. So here's my point. Radiometric dating has been shown to not work on rocks of known age. Evolutionists assume it works on rocks of unknown age. That's really what it comes down to. Kind of like if I gave you a calculator, Merry Christmas, here's your calculator, and you push in 2 plus 2 equals, and it gives you 57,212.3. So I don't think I trust that calculator, right? I'd say, don't worry, it works on big numbers. I don't know. I mean, if it doesn't work on the small ones, why would I trust? That doesn't make sense, right? What about carbon dating? For some reason, a lot of people think carbon dating gives the millions of years. It does not. Carbon dating is more reliable. Now, it's not perfect either because it's also based on assumptions. But at least with carbon dating, when we test it on things of known age, we tend to get the right answer. And so I have a lot more confidence in carbon dating. Apparently, the assumptions are better there. But the way it works is most carbon is stable. It's C12, but there's a variety of it that has two extra neutrons. C14, it's unstable. It will decay into nitrogen with a half-life of 5,700 years. And so it doesn't last millions of years. But and it's generated in the upper atmosphere when cosmic rays bombard nitrogen atoms and they convert them into C14, and then they'll decay back into nitrogen over time. So there's a small fraction of C14 in the atmosphere. Plants take that in because they breathe in, right, the carbon dioxide, and they use the carbon to build themselves. And then you eat the plants, and so you've got a little bit of C14 in you. Most of the carbon in you is carbon-12, but you're all just a little bit unstable because you have that C14 in you, okay? And that's decaying into nitrogen as we speak. Now, while you're alive, you continue to replace it because you take in new food, right? And so you're replacing that C14, but then when you die, you don't eat anymore, you don't breathe anymore, and so that C14 simply decays away. And so the idea is, with carbon dating, it can tell you how long ago something died. You know, it only works on things that have carbon in them. And it works best on things that were alive, because then we know they're in equilibrium with their environment. But if even 1 million years had elapsed, there would be no C14 left. If the entire Earth were nothing but C14, after 1 million years, you wouldn't have a single atom left. It decays that quickly, because the half-life is only 5,700 years. So it decays quickly. And yet we found it in diamonds that secular scientists believe to be 1 to 2 billion years old based on these other radiometric dating techniques of some of the minerals within them. And yet the carbon dating limits their age to a few thousand years. We've dated dinosaur fossils. We've taken dinosaur fossils, and sometimes they have enough carbon left in them, and you can send them in and have them carbon dated. And we sent them into secular labs so we couldn't be accused of bias. They found C14 in them, and that limits the age to a few thousand years. So even dinosaurs are not millions or hundreds of millions of years old. They're not. There's lots of processes like that. You tend not to hear about these in most public schools. I didn't hear about most of these when I went through the system. But the rate at which salt flows into the ocean, even fresh water has a little bit of salt in it. It picks it up from the continents, dumps it in the ocean. The water just evaporates, but it leaves the salt. Oceans get slightly saltier every year by 450 million tons of salt. And so you run the math backwards, and you'd say, how old could the ocean possibly be? And the answer is, it can't be older than 62 million years, because at that point, it would have zero salt. And that's an upper limit, right? Because you can't have less salt than no salt, right? So if the ocean started salty, which they did, the true age would be much less than that. But my point is, it's not consistent with the secular age of 3 billion years, right? Just based on the salt content, it has to be less than 62 million years, which is consistent with creation, not consistent with the evolutionary view. Likewise, the rate at which mud accumulates on the ocean floor, we can measure that. It's about 20 billion tons per year. And you can get rid of a little bit of it with plate tectonic subduction, but that gets rid of 1 billion tons a year maximum. The other 19 billion tons simply accumulate. It takes less than 12 million years to accumulate the current amount of mud on the ocean floor. And again, that's assuming it started with no mud, and that's assuming there was no worldwide flood, which is going to obviously dump a lot of mud very quickly on the ocean floor. So it's very consistent with biblical creation. It's not consistent with billions of years. Human population growth. How long does it take to get Earth's current population from two people? Nowhere near millions of years. Not even close. The seculars have a real tough time with this one. It just doesn't make sense from their point of view. Because, we know we have historic records, at least estimates, of the population. And we can do the math and figure that out, and you find that human beings have only been on the planet a few thousand years. And granted, you have to account for different mortality rates. It's a little bit complicated, but you can't get it to be millions of years. It just doesn't work. But the best evidence that the world is young is what the Bible teaches. In Exodus 20:11, God tells us that He made everything in 6 days, and human beings were made on the sixth day, and that was a few thousand years ago. And of course, it's very clear those are ordinary days from context, bounded by an evening and a morning and so on. We have the birth certificate of the universe, and that's the best way to know the age of something, is to check the birth certificate, which we have. So it kind of comes down to this. The secular scientists say the Earth's billions of years old, take my word for it. God says I created in 6 days, take my word for it. That's really the issue, isn't it? What about these fossils that we find? And we do find fossils all over the world. That's what I'd expect, because there was a worldwide flood. That's going to kill lots of organisms, so they're going to be dead. It's going to bury them in mud. Mud under the right conditions, under flood conditions, can harden and turn into rock. And the minerals will move in, and usually the soft part has time to decay, but the bone remains and permineralizes. The minerals come and fill in all the holes in the bone, and you get a fossil. I always had the impression this took millions of years, but really it can happen pretty quickly. This is a fossil ichthyosaur, a marine reptile, fossilized in the process of giving birth. You see the baby ichthyosaur being born there? They're born tail first because they're air breathers, and so as soon as he's born, he has to swim to the surface and get his first breath of air, which is kind of neat. Here's a fish fossilized eating another fish, and you can see even some of the soft tissue is left there. So it happened pretty quick. See, most things don't become a fossil. People think you die and then over millions of years you fossilize, you turn into a stone. No, it's not normally what happens, right? Yeah, most things decay, and to illustrate this, I've been picking on dogs, we'll pick on cats now. We're gonna do an experiment on our dead cat, Earl, all right? And we're gonna watch him slowly fossilize over millions of years, yes? Well, let's see what happens. Day one, dead cat on grass. Okay, let's wait a little while. Day three, smelly dead cat on grass. That's what happens. Day nine, very smelly dead cat on grass. This is not looking good for Earl. Day 20, part of Earl's missing. Yeah, some of that soft tissue's decayed away. Day 38, more of Earl missing. All that soft tissue is decayed away. And day 65, everything's decayed away. It's been recycled back into the environment, right? And we know that happens. You've seen animals that have been killed on the side of the road. They don't slowly become statues over millions of years. They get picked off by scavengers that are recycled back into the environment. You want to make a fossil, you got to bury something. You got to protect it from the environment. And even then, I was given the wrong impression. I was taught that, you know, these fish that we find, and again, we find fish on continents, which is interesting. It makes sense if there's a worldwide flood. But I was taught that the fish dies, it sinks down to the bottom, it's slowly covered by sediment over millions of years. But, you know, think about that. If this layer of sediment was deposited a million years after that layer, the top of the fish would have had plenty of time to decay. And so obviously if you want to make a fossil, you have to do it quickly. If not, the fish will decay. It'll be picked up by scavengers and recycled back into the environment. Now, if you really want to form a fossil fish, here's how you do it. You go home to your aquarium, and you dump some concrete in it, okay? Now, that's going to kill our poor fish, and it's going to trap him in those layers there. And generally, there's enough bacteria left, they're able to eat away at the soft tissue, but the bones permineralize. The minerals move in there and fill all the holes in the bone, and so you end up with a stone that's in the shape of your original bone. And that makes sense. And you can do that, and it doesn't take millions of years. It can happen very quickly. I'm going to skip some of these for time's sake. What about the type of fossils that we find? Do we find evidence of evolution, one kind changing into another? Well, here we have the evolution of the horse, right? That's what you'll find in textbooks. And I'm thinking, I see different varieties of horse. And that's what I'd expect as a biblical creationist, because there are different varieties of horse today. And they have little differences. They're, you know, the way their feet is a little bit different. Okay, and their number of ribs are different. By the way, if you put them in the order of increasing ribs, it's not the same order as size. Isn't that interesting? They don't tell you that. But in any case, these are just different varieties of horse. You say, but this one's really small, so it must have evolved into that one. You don't know that. These are both adult horses. They're just different breeds. Okay? They're both adults. They're just different breeds. They're just different varieties. And so there's lots of different varieties of horse today, and there are some varieties that haven't survived until today. But you don't find a non-horse changing into a horse. And that is characteristic of what we find in the fossils. We find variation within a kind, which is exactly what we'd expect if biblical creation is true. There'll always be a handful of disputed transitional specimens, right, which the evolutionists usually themselves shoot down after a few years. But in any case, you don't find a continuum of one kind changing another. You just don't find it. What about the rocks themselves? Don't rocks take millions of years to form? Here's a set of car keys embedded inside solid rock. I don't think that took millions of years to form, unless cars have been around a lot longer than I thought they were. Here's a man-made clock embedded inside solid rock. That's interesting. I guess we know when it happened. There's these rock layers. You say, well, surely all those rock layers took millions of years to be deposited, right? Look how many there are. There's a person down there for scale. Well, I got news for you. Those rock layers did not exist before 1980. Those were produced in the Mount St. Helens eruption. It sloshed a wave in Spirit Lake and deposited all kinds of new sedimentary rock layers. Very fine laminations in them. One Piddly volcano did that, and then it cut out a canyon, 1/40th of the scale of the Grand Canyon in a matter of days, maybe even hours. It doesn't take millions of years to do this kind of stuff. catastrophic conditions will do it very quickly. Has there ever been a point in history where the entire earth had catastrophic conditions? Yes, there was. There was a worldwide flood. And they used to tell you that these layers that you see here, which you find in things like the Tapete sandstone, those are annual layers, you see. They're deposited 1 year after the next. Well, they now know that's not true because those were all deposited in that Mount St. Helens eruption. They're produced simultaneously. And they're the same kind of layers you find in the Tapete sandstone, which covers much of the United States and Canada. One of our geologists at ICR, Dr. Tim Clary, has been mapping these huge rock units that cover continents. Just obvious evidence for a worldwide flood. It's very compelling. So you see, when we take a look at these rock layers and the fossils within them, we're applying good observational science, right? This is something we can test and repeat in the present. We find that it's very consistent with recent creation and a worldwide flood. It's not consistent with gradual evolution and gradual depositing over millions of years. And so when you come to these rock units that you see, and there's some spectacular rock units that we come across. You know, sometimes when you go down the road, if there's a hill, it's pretty flat out here, but I grew up in Rolling Hills, Ohio, and they cut through these hills and you'd see these amazing sections of rock. It's quite stunning. And you know, evolutionists look at that and they say, yeah, those were millions of years of evolution. That's not really what they represent. They represent the worldwide flood. And the worldwide flood is our reminder that God judges sin. The real message of the rocks, therefore, is repent. Yeah, that's what it comes down to. And so you see, you can even use this evidence, this science, as a segue into the gospel. The Bible really is true. And if it's true, that means God really is a righteous God and he will judge sin. But he's also a merciful God and he made a way of escape, right? And that way is Jesus Christ. During the worldwide flood, God provided the ark. God told Noah how to design it and everything. And that was sort of a symbol for salvation day. The Bible says Noah was a preacher of righteousness. He was out there preaching, come on board the ark and be saved. And for all the perhaps billions of people that were on the earth at that time, there could have been billions of people. Only 8 responded, right? Noah's immediate family. And we have that. We need to be preaching that message today as well. And that judgment is coming, but God is merciful. And if you'd but cry out to him, he would be more than happy to save you from the judgment to come. But there will come a point when judgment will come. And that door of opportunity will close. I think it's interesting and significant. The Bible says that God was the one that closed the door on the ark. Isn't that interesting? God was the one that decided time of mercy is over, time of judgment begins. And we don't know when that'll be for each of us. The Bible says it's appointed once for men to die, and after this comes judgment. We don't know when that's going to be for us. We don't. People assume, well, that's distant future. You don't know. We have lots of resources on these topics, which I'd encourage you to get. Everything I've talked about today is in our Creation Basics and Beyond, one of the books that you can get over on our, I think we have that. Did we bring that one? Oh yeah, we got that one. Okay, good. Creation Basics done by all of our staff scientists at ICR. And we have a, you say, why that looks thick and intimidating? We have a student version as well called Guide to Creation Basics, so you might want to get that as well. Taking Back Astronomy, this is a book that I wrote on my own subject of astronomy and how it confirms biblical creation. What about black holes and what about distant starlight and things like that? All answered in that book. You say, what about, is there one bulletproof argument for biblical creation that I can memorize and I don't have to know a whole lot about science? The answer is yes, there is. Now granted, I think it's good to know a little bit about science as well, so you can talk intelligently about these subjects, but yeah, there is a bulletproof argument for biblical creation. It's not what you probably think it is. It's very different, but it's very powerful. I've been using this for years and nobody's been able to come back from it. Understanding Genesis. Are the days in Genesis really ordinary days? I heard somebody say that the Hebrew word could mean a long period of time. What's up with that? This book's going to show you that Genesis, it really does mean what it says. It's been translated well. The people who translated the Bible really did know what they were doing for the most part. And it's going to show you how you can know that Genesis really does mean what it says. Discerning truth. How to spot logical fallacies in arguments that evolutionists make. That's kind of a nice skill, isn't it? To know something about logic, which they don't teach at most schools these days. I think that's necessary in order for them to teach evolution, quite honestly. Your origins matter. Your origins really do matter. Why is this issue important? Maybe you have a friend who says, well, it doesn't really matter what you believe about Genesis, just trust in Jesus. This would be the DVD you'd want to get them. We have lots of DVDs on various topics. Created Cosmos, where I take you on a tour through the universe as a planetarium show I wrote for the Creation Museum. Secret Code of Creation, which is going to show you that God has built incredible beauty and complexity into a place you would never have expected. And there is no secular explanation for it. And I'll just leave it at that, because it's cool. You need to see that one. Stargazer's Guide to the Night Sky, how to better enjoy the night sky from a Christian perspective. If you've ever wanted to know what's that bright star that's been hanging over in the west, that's Venus actually. And what about that constellation? What is that? It's got star charts, and it'll show you how to find that. If you want to get a telescope, what type you might want to get, what you can see with it. But even what you can see naked eye, that's a fun resource. Acts and Facts. Now, you all should be getting Acts and Facts because it is free, and therefore for you, right? Acts and Facts. How many of you are already getting Acts and Facts magazine? Very few. Okay, the rest of you need to repent of that sin and sign up. It is free. Not too many things free in life, just salvation and Acts and Facts. So sign-up sheet looks like that. It's a monthly magazine. We just want to bless you, and I think you'll really enjoy it. It's, again, written by our staff scientists and theologians at ICR. And check us out on the web, icr.org, and if you want to see how articles slowly evolve over millions of years, check out my blog and read some of the comments on that. We do have a few minutes for questions. Any questions? Yeah.
Mark, let me give you this mic so I can hear you.
Okay, one of the questions I had about astronomy is, modern astronomers say that the visible light is only, 0.44% of the matter and energy combined out there, and yet we can get clear pictures of a galaxy that is 15 billion light years away. If the galaxy, if the amount of matter is where they say it is, how is there not a limit to how far we can see?
Okay, yeah. How is there not a limit to how far we can see? There is a limit to how far we can see. The bigger the telescope you have, the more light you can collect, and the more sensitive detector you have, the more photons you can count. So there is a limit.
Right, but why isn't the interstellar gases and so on, why isn't there an opacity level that says beyond this, the amount of gases over that distance do not create an opaque layer that we can't see through?
Gotcha. The answer is there's not very much opacity in space. There is some. And it's limited primarily to the disk of our galaxy. Our galaxy does have some gas and dust, and it's dust mainly that does a lot of the obscuring. And so we can't. There's actually what's called the zone of avoidance. If you see plots of galaxies beyond ours, there's a band where they're all missing. They're not really missing. It's just we can't see them there because our galaxy is thick in that direction. It's optically thick. But if you're looking at any other angle, our galaxy is pretty thin optically. And then between galaxies, there's very little matter between galaxies. So there's not much that's lost. It's primarily within a galaxy that you lose a little bit of the light. So we're able to see tremendous distances because of that and because of the advances in technology. The bigger the telescope, the farther out you can see, the fainter galaxies you can see.
But wouldn't that refute the dark matter model of the universe?
No, it doesn't refute dark matter because dark matter is invisible. Dark matter is something that we suspect it's there because it exerts a gravitational pull on something else, and yet it's not visible. And we don't know what it is, but obviously it can't be something that obscures, and so it can't be ordinary gas. We don't know what dark matter is. We don't. But there's good evidence that it's there, and it's transparent.
Okay. So, do you think that the flood and the pressure of the flood all over the Earth could affect the C14 and carbon dating, or does it still have its natural course, regardless of how much pressure is put on it?
Yeah, the question about the flood and would it affect C14. It has an enormous effect on it, but not because of pressure. It's because we think like I said, all of those age estimates are based on assumptions, and the one they normally use for carbon dating assumes that the C14 in the atmosphere has always been constant. We think it wasn't. We think that before the flood, there was only about 2% of the modern C14 in the atmosphere, partly because it hadn't had a chance to build up very much yet. The Earth just wasn't very old, and so it hadn't had a chance to accumulate enough C14. That's one reason, and also all of the Earth's biomatter was absorbed in the flood. It's a little bit complicated to go into the details, but basically that changes the ratio of C14 to C12. And if you don't compensate for that and you date something that goes back to the flood year, you'll get an age that's about 10 times older than the true age. And so if you're wondering why we get carbon dates, which we occasionally do, of 50,000 years instead of maybe 5,000, That's why. It's because the C14 in the atmosphere has not been constant. So for that reason, carbon dating works very well up to about 3,000 years in the past. And at that point, the atmospheric differences, it deviates from truth very substantially by the time you get back to the flood year. But the interesting thing is you never get more than about 50,000 years, even on stuff like dinosaurs. So you still find C14 in them. So they're not millions of years old.
Dr. Lyle, before you take any more questions, for those of you who have small children that you don't want to leave, most people who are looking after them, and for the rest of you, you can stay and ask Dr. Lyle some more questions. Kelton, let me get this mic to you.
So the evidence is there. Why don't they have it down?
It's a spiritual issue. The Bible says in Romans 1, verse 18, the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who suppress the truth and unrighteousness. So the Bible makes it very clear. People know who God is. That doesn't mean they know everything about it, but they have some knowledge that God exists and that he is who he is and that we've offended his moral standard. And the Bible says they suppress the truth and unrighteousness. Romans 1:18 doesn't say because they just don't know any better or they don't have enough evidence. It says because they suppress the truth and unrighteousness. Verse 19 says, what has been made known of God, for God shown it to them. And then verse 20, that it says that there's no excuse. For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. And the Greek words there, without excuse, means without a defense. It's an apologia, without an apologetic. Isn't that interesting? And so it comes down to a spiritual issue. Unbelievers don't want to believe in a God who is rightly angry at them for their sin. That is uncomfortable. That is very uncomfortable. And so ultimately, the reason why people make up standards like evolution is to protect them from a God that is rightly angry at them, that they don't want to believe in. And then, of course, that gets passed on innocently. They think, well, they're not innocent, but there's a culpable ignorance there. There's a culpable ignorance, and they pass it on, and then some people think they're only taught. They're not exposed to this kind of evidence. And so they think, well, maybe there really is some science to support evolution. But the reason it continues, it's not because of evidence. You've seen that. It's because it's a spiritual issue. Yeah.
Wait, I have a second question.
Okay.
That if this is fraud that you're teaching, and it is scientifically proven to be fraud, is it not illegal that for them to be teaching that in public?
Well, publics, this is going to offend some people, but I'm going to say it anyway. Public school is an inherent contradiction in terms, because education, as public, education should be neutral, because it represents everybody. But education by its nature cannot be neutral, because the very subjects you choose causes you to make a value judgment. And so I can't resolve a problem that is inherently contradictory. There's no solution to public education. There is no solution to it. It's not really biblical anyway. Now, am I saying that it's a sin? I'm not talking about that. I'm not saying that it's always a sin to send your kids to public school. Some Christians do that. I would think it over very carefully before I would do that, though, because they're going to be trained to think as secularists. And I wouldn't do that with my children. There might be a few exceptions. There might be a few public schools that have a lot of good Christian teachers in them. If you're a Christian teacher in a public school, praise God for you. You are a missionary in a pagan system. That's the way I look at it. So in terms of the legalities of it, our country is the way that it is. I mean, our country was founded on biblical principles, but we've deviated from that. And so, again, my goal is not to necessarily change the education. My goal is to reach people with the gospel message, showing that the Bible's true. And then when the people become convinced that the Bible's true, the law code will then follow that. A lot of people want to do it in reverse, and they want to, we change the laws and enforce Christian principles, and then that makes Christians. No, the gospel makes Christians, and then our law code, because we're a democracy, our law code would follow from that. Right. If this nation became Christian, the law code would become Christian too. It just would. So I hope I didn't offend too many people, but I think that's biblical.
So would you say you believe in certain forms of evolution, like speciation or?
Yeah, I believe in speciation, and sometimes they call that microevolution. That's fine. The word evolution can just mean change, right? I believe in certain kinds of change. But a lot of times what evolutionists will do is they'll use an equivocation fallacy or a bait and switch. They'll change the meaning of the word evolution in the middle of an argument. So you believe that bacteria evolve resistance to penicillin? Well, they do change in that way, right? So you believe in evolution in the Darwinian sense? No, I don't. That's a different thing, because that involves an increase in information, and the process we observe decrease information. Sometimes I clarify by saying I reject molecules to man evolution. And you might notice we use that phrase, or particles to people evolution. We do that not to be overly wordy. We do it to be precise.
Some of the examples you used for Earth dating and stuff rely on present day rates of change. And I'm sure you guys have. I mean, how do we know conditions haven't changed to where present day rates of change have been consistent throughout time versus, you know, what if, you know, we say a day is defined by 1 year of light, 1 year of darkness, as the Bible determines a day. And we know that we have a year of light and a year of darkness because it's one full rotation of the Earth. Well, how do we know the Earth is always rotated at this speed? And so a day now is the same as a day previously as a day before that.
In a way, you sort of, there's sort of two questions there. It's reasonable to think that the days were days because those are linked with months and years, and the Bible set that up very early in Genesis. God created the stars to be for signs, seasons, days, and years. And so he designed those things to be clocks. Yeah. And so we have every reason to think that those are pretty consistent. The Earth's rotation does slow very slightly because the moon steals a little bit of energy of it and moves away. But it's a fraction of a second. Since creation, the Earth's rotation has slowed very slightly, but it's a minuscule amount. And so we have good scriptural reason to believe that has been pretty constant, okay? Now, what about these other things, though, that we say, you know, the rate at which salt goes into the ocean, has that always been constant? Probably not. What we do when we use these particular kinds of arguments is we're doing a reductio ad absurdum. What we're doing is we're saying, I'm going to assume for the sake of argument the evolutionists' standard, because they tend to believe that rates and conditions are basically constant. And then I show that even based on their own standard, you don't get billions of years. Okay, and so I'm refuting their standard by temporarily assuming their conditions. Not that I actually agree with those conditions. I don't believe that the rate at which salt has flowed to the ocean has been constant, because the worldwide flood would have upset that tremendously. I don't believe that the rate of mud on the ocean floor has been constant, because the flood would have dumped a lot of mud on the ocean floor. But my point is, even if I, for the sake of hypothesis, assume my opponent's position, it still leads to a contradiction in his thinking. And so that's a very effective way of refuting your opponent, is to show that even on his own terms, his worldview blows itself up. Very effective way of debating. It's a reductio ad absurdum. So yes, we're not affirming that those rates have been constant. We're just pointing out that even if they were, you can't get millions or billions of years in many cases.
Ernest, that question.
So what is your take on light years? If the Earth has only been around for as long as you say it is, just 2,000 years, and there are stars that are billions of light years away, but according to the speed of light, we can see them now. How does that add up? Like, was the universe created in a different time? Is the theory of light speed incorrect?
No, it's just that a lot of people don't realize that the it's a complicated answer, and I am going to answer it in more detail at the conference. If you're able to come, I'll be answering that question, and it's going to take 15 minutes to give the full answer, just so you know. The brief answer is the speed of light is very unusual. It's not like speeds of other things. It's an upper limit on any speed, and it turns out the speed of light is only measurable as a round trip speed. We can measure a beam of light by sending it out, bouncing it off a mirror, bringing it back, get the total time, the total distance, you know, divide by two, it has to make the trip, right? And that's an average speed of light. We don't know that it's the same going out as it is coming in. And amazingly, the speed of light in any one direction is not measurable without first assuming it. I know that's very counterintuitive. I'm going to explain at the conference why that is. But the long story short is, you can actually define the one-way speed of light however you like, and the Bible apparently defines it as being instantaneous. And that is permissible within Einstein's physics. Einstein knew that. He wrote about it. But basically, just because the universe is big and it's really big doesn't mean it has to be really old. You can actually get the light from those galaxies to Earth instantaneously, even today, because the one-way speed, the incoming speed, need not be the same as the outgoing speed. That's the 2-minute version. The 15-minute version, come to the conference. It's also in Creation Basics and Beyond. There's a chapter on that in there. Yeah. Any others?
Let's thank Dr. Lisle.